Greetings again today in that name that's far above every name, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. You that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium. You out in the radio listening audience could do someone a favor and do us a favor if you get on that phone and call a friend. Have them to tune in and get this hour coming up. I know it can be a blessing to people. No doubt there's many shut-ins would enjoy listening to this hour, and you'll be helping them. We thank God for the beautiful day. We have an auspicious day in which to worship. I believe anybody complain about this kind of weather would complain about the kind of coffin you buried them in. I'm speaking today on the subject, the death of Aaron. And that'll be tape 251. I'll be glad to send you a list of at least 250 tape. You write in and request the list. You can choose the ones you want. I have many sermons on prophecy, such as the coming man of sin, the mark of the beast, the coming of the Lord, the tribulation period, the millennium, and many other great sermons, prophetic sermons that you'd enjoy, as well as other great messages in singing and music. And write in and get a list of these tape. And when you're writing, request our brochure on our proposed Holy Land tour. We'd gladly get it in the mail to you. Now these tape, we'll send out for a gift of $3. The gift is used to help defray our radio expense. My mail was greatly off this past week. And I'm calling on you in the radio listening audience. If you appreciated the good singing today and appreciate the service, the message, write to me. Next week, write me a letter after we go off there today. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. If you have your Bible today, turn to Numbers chapter 20. The book of Numbers chapter 20 on page 194 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. Turn then, follow me as I read from God's Word. I was reading the other day about this woman that took seriously ill. Her husband called the pastor in to pray for her. She's coming close to the end of life's journey. And the pastor came. He's one of these preachers that pray all the way around the world. And the husband said, I want you to pray for my wife. Doesn't look like she's going to make it. And pray if it be God's will that God will raise her up. And so the preacher started praying. He prayed all the way across the United States, over into Hawaii, prayed all the way over into Formosa, prayed all the way through China, came back through Vietnam and Japan, prayed all the way through England and France and Germany, prayed through Russia, prayed all the way through Canada, came back down through the north, back down to where he was, and then he started praying for the woman. And after he finished his prayer, he said to the husband, did she seem to be any better? He said, no, she died while you was in China. I'm sorry to warn you. So when you pray, you need to tell God what you need, what you want, get right to the point, not pray all the way around the world. And that's the way to get your prayers answered. Amen? Well, thank you for them too. And maybe the other will get in on it later. Well, good to have the Word of God open today at Numbers chapter 20. And I begin reading with verse 23. Follow me in the scriptures. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in Mount Hor by the coast of the land of Edom, saying, Aaron shall be gathered unto his people. He shall not enter into the land which I have given unto the children of Israel, because ye rebelled against my word at the water of Meribah. Take Aaron and Eleazar his son, and bring them up unto Mount Hor, and strip Aaron of his garments, and put them upon Eleazar his son, and Aaron shall be gathered unto his people, and shall die there. And Moses did as the Lord commanded, and they went up into Mount Hor in the sight of all the congregation. And Moses stripped Aaron of his garments, and put them upon Eleazar his son. Aaron died there in the top of the mount, And Moses and Eleazar came down from the mount, and when all the congregation saw that Aaron was dead, they mourned for Aaron 30 days, even all the house of Israel. Now Aaron here was the brother of Moses. He is some 3 years older than Moses. He is born before Pharaoh issued the decree that all the male children should be born, put in the river, of course, or put to death. And he was a son of Amrad and Josabek. And they had a sister named Miriam. But Aaron is about 3 years older than Moses, his brother. Now, in the death of Aaron, you'll find he prefigures and the means of worship in the wilderness and needed a priest, a high priest, to perform these duties. And God said, Aaron is the man. And God ordained him, and there he was dressed for the occasion, anointed for the occasion. He became the high priest in the camp of Israel. But he worked hand in hand with his brother Moses. You remember when Moses came out of the place of Midian, where he had spent some 40 years, where God had told him, instructed him to go and bring the people out of the land of Egypt. He said, I'm not a good speaker. I'm not a good orator. And he began to put up an excuse. But God said, I made your mouth. But he continued to put up an excuse. And God said, all right, I will let your brother Aaron be your spokesman. And so Aaron came and met Moses. And they went back into the land of Egypt. And then Aaron informed the people there as to why Moses had come back to Egypt. Remember, he had been gone for 40 years. Aaron had been there these 40 years. He knew everything that was taking place there. He knew that God's people were under great pressure. And he carries Moses into Pharaoh and tells him what his mission is. And then they lead God's people out and starts through the wilderness. And then on one occasion, we find that Moses and Aaron rebelled against God. And because of that, they had to die. They could not go into the land of Canaan. They were leading the people of God out of Egypt toward the land of Canaan. They could have made that journey in 40 days, but God caused them to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. Instead of a 40-day journey, they had a 40-year journey. They circled round and around, God trying to correct them, teach them, and cause them to be obedient to him. And so we find even their leaders became disobedient at times. Aaron made a golden calf out of the earrings and jewelry of the people. And that's when Moses had gone up on Mount Sinai to get the law. And when he came back down, Aaron had the people worshiping a golden calf, which is a big bull calf, the god of Egypt in those days. And they said, now this is the God that goes before us. And we don't know what happened to Moses. He's left us. He brought us out of the land of Egypt. Why were we in the land of Egypt? They worshiped the big bull calf there in the land of Egypt as their God. And so they worshiped that golden calf. And Aaron was responsible for that because he listened to the people and did what they wanted to do. And of course, we find again that Moses and Aaron became disobedient to God at Meribah. Now Moses smote the rock the second time when God said, speak to it the second time. He smote it one time. God said, speak the second time. He smote it the second time. And of course, Aaron was right along with him in what he did. And God said, all right, now because of your disobedience, I'm going to cut you off. I'll not let Aaron, I'll not let Moses go into the land of Canaan. Now they led God's people right up to the brink of the land, just very near the Dead Sea. I've been there where they buried this man Aaron. And they have a big monument there, of course, in behalf of his tomb, his burial. And I've been there where Moses died also. They have a huge building there. I've been there several times on our trip from over in Jordan, Amman, Jordan, down to Petra. And we've seen this place more than one time. But anyway, they had to die. They had to pay the price. And God said to Moses, I want you to look over the River Jordan, and I'll let you get a glimpse of the promised land. But Moses, you can't go in. You disobeyed me. I'll not let you go in. And that gang of people that became disobedient in the wilderness, they all died out. God raised up Joshua to lead the younger generation across the river of Jordan after they had buried Moses and Aaron, and they went on into the promised land. But I want to talk about the death of Aaron, not the death of Moses necessarily. Now I want you to notice, number one, he knew of it beforehand. Aaron knew he was going to die. Aaron knew that he must pay that price because of his disobedience. The Lord revealed to Aaron that he was to be gathered unto his people. The Bible says in verses 23 and 24, "And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in Mount Hor, by the coast of the land of Edom, saying, Aaron shall be gathered unto his people. He shall not enter into the land which I have given unto the children of Israel, because he rebelled against my word at the water of Meribah." And so Aaron knew he was to die. God said, "You must die. You must die. I'm going to gather you unto your people." That's exactly what happens to Christians when they die. They are gathered unto their people in the paradise of God. If you should die today as a child of God, only your body would go to the grave. You would go to meet with your people on the other side. You'd be gathered unto your loved ones that's gone on to be with the Lord. And so Aaron knew beforehand that he was going to die. Likewise, Jesus knew the time and manner of his death. In Luke chapter 9, verses 30 and 31, "And behold, there talked with him two men, which was Moses and Elias, who appeared in glory and spake of his decease, which he should accomplish at Jerusalem." Now Jesus knew he must go to Jerusalem. He must die. Moses and Elijah came down to meet with him, and there talked with him about this death. And they talked about his death in Jerusalem. Jesus knew exactly when he was going to die. Jesus said on one occasion, "My time is not yet. My time to die is not yet." He knew the exact time. In Matthew chapter 20 and verse 28, "Even as the Son of Man came not to minister unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many." And Jesus knew he had come for that purpose and knew he must die in Jerusalem. So Aaron, knowing the time of his death that he must die, Jesus knew the time of his death and that he must die. So I want you to see how the death of Aaron prefigures the death of Christ. Number two, it was sudden. Aaron's death became sudden. The Bible tells us Aaron went up to Mount Hor for the purpose of dying. No time of sickness hinted here. The Bible didn't say he was sick, he had a terrible disease, or he was very feeble. Doesn't say that. He was 123 years old. But as far as we know, he was in good health, and his death came suddenly because God said he must die. Didn't say he had cancer. Didn't say he had a heart attack. Didn't say he was eaten up with arthritis. The Bible just said he died. He was a real strong man at the age of 123. Now, Moses was as strong at the age of 120 as he was at the age of 40. Now, God kept them in health. And so we see he had been cut off suddenly, and so was the Lord Jesus Christ. The Messiah shall be cut off, so saith the Bible. In John chapter 19 and verse 33, "But when they came to Jesus and saw he was dead already, they brake not his legs." See, they nailed Jesus to the cross, and then the law said, "You must not let a man hang on the cross alive after the sun goes down." And so they broke the legs of the two thieves that died by his side. And they said, "We better break the man's legs on the middle cross too, because we want him to die before the sun goes down." They went and checked Jesus to break his legs, and he was dead already. Jesus already died. And so the soldier just took that spear and penetrated up into his heart, and out came blood and water. The Son of God died suddenly. He didn't linger on like the thieves there that were on the crosses beside him. They lingered on until their legs were broken to hasten their death, but not the Savior. Now the soldier expected him to linger on for a while and died, but the Bible said, "Reproach hath broken my heart." In Psalms chapter 69 and verse 20, prophecy pertaining to Jesus on the cross said, "Reproach hath broken my heart." The Son of God died with a broken heart. His heart was broken as he hanged there on the cross. It was broken before that soldier put that spear in it. Jesus died of a broken heart on Calvary, becoming sin for us, he that knew no sin. And so the soldiers thought, well, this man will linger on like the others. He seemed to be in health. He seemed to be a strong man. We better go to the three crosses and hasten their death. But they found that Jesus already died of a broken heart on Calvary. And so we see then Aaron died suddenly, so did the Son of God. Number three, it was because of sin. Aaron died because of sin. Jesus died because of sin. Now let me explain what I mean by that and get what I have to say. In verse 24, Aaron shall be gathered unto his people, for he shall not enter into the land which I have given unto the children of Israel, because he rebelled against my word at the water of Meribah. The Bible says here that Aaron died because of his sin he committed at the waters of Meribah. And so Aaron had to pay the penalty because of that sin. And so did Jesus Christ pay the penalty for sin, not that he had sinned, but the reason Jesus died was to pay for my sins and your sins. He paid for our sins. Sin was imputed unto him, and he died there upon Calvary. God placed sin, that is, it was imputed upon Aaron, and he died there on Mount Hor. But Jesus died. It was not imputed unto him, not his sin, because he did not commit sin, but our sin was laid upon him. Now, sin was imputed unto Aaron because he committed that sin and died because of it. Christ died for our sins, but not his own sin, because he never committed sin. He bore our sin in his own body. The Bible says he that knew no sin became a sin offering. Became sin for us. That means he became a sin offering. God required the blood of his son, the death of his son, as a sin offering. All through Old Testament years, the high priest, even Aaron himself, would go in and offer the lamb on the altar, shed the blood, carry the blood in the Holy of Holies, and God looked over their sins for a solid year. And then that was repeated. But Jesus died, shedding his own blood, and God required the blood of his only son to pay for our sins and the death thereof. The blood of Aaron couldn't do it. The blood of goats and lambs and turtle doves couldn't do it. God said the only thing that will atone and pay the sin debt of the human race would be the perfect blood of my son, a lamb without spot and without blemish. Now, Jesus Christ was that lamb without spot and without blemish. That's the only thing God would accept. Now, that's why Jesus died, because your sins and my sins and all the sins of Adam right on down to the end of the millennium was laid upon him on Calvary. When Jesus died on the cross, he paid for all sin that's ever committed upon this earth. That was terrible. All the sins that's been committed today, and all the sins have been committed from Adam until now, and all the sins that ever be committed under the end of the millennium, every one of them was placed upon Jesus Christ on Calvary. And he paid that debt. God said that sin must be paid for. Now, when Jesus Christ paid that sin debt and satisfied a holy God, God said then, all right, every human being that wants to be saved and have that sin paid for by this blood and that be accepted by me, he must accept my son as his savior. God said if he does accept my son as his savior, he'll die and go to hell and be punished in hell forever because of his sins. So people don't have to go to hell and pay for their sins in hell and to be paying for them forever and ever, never get them paid for. They can accept Jesus Christ has already paid that sin debt. It's been paid for on Calvary. And all a sinner has to do is accept that and believe that and trust Christ, and he'll never have to go to hell and suffer in the flames of burning hell. But you go on as a sinner. Some of you out there on the radio listen on it. You're living like the devil, out drinking, carousing out last night, drunk on beer, drunk on wine, taking dope, living like the devil, out on the dance floor, out gambling, and mistreating your family, and you're headed straight to hell as you can go. And you're going if you don't get right with God. If you don't repent and get saved, you're burning hell forever. and you lead your family into hell. There's many of a man that's led his entire family into hell because he refused to get right with God. He refused to get saved, refused to go to church. He refused to take his wife and children to church. He died and went to hell, and they died and went to hell. And some of you are doing the same thing. You're going to die and go to hell and lead your family in the flames of a terrible hell. Now, you listen to this preacher. I'm telling you the truth. Don't you cut that radio off. You listen to this preacher. I'm telling you the truth. You're going to die and face God. It's appointed a man wants to die, and after that, the judgment. You listen to what I have to say. Let me have your ears. And you don't know how close death may be to your door right now. It may come before night. Your body may be in the mortuary before in the morning. And if you're not right with God and you die like that, you'll be burning and screaming in hell when the sun goes down tonight. You need to get right with God. God had you to listen to this broadcast today. You just didn't casually cut it on. Your wife didn't just cut it on and hear it herself. God meant for you to hear it. And God wants you to listen to what this preacher has to say. You'll answer for it when you face God. Now let's move on to thought number four. We find he murmured not in face of his death. Now when Aaron found out he must die, then he didn't murmur about it. He didn't complain about it. He didn't gripe about it. He knew that he was guilty, and he knew he must die. He knew he must pay that debt. It's most significant that through all this trying time, Aaron's voice is not heard. You don't hear him where he complained a minute. There's a man praying one time, and he thought he was going to die, and he said, "Now, Lord, I've been a terrible, wicked man in my life, and I'm just too wicked to die and come to heaven, and I want you to let me live a little longer because I'm too mean to die now." Now, God doesn't hold people back on that account. When God says, "Let's go," you got to go. When God calls, you must go, whether you're wicked or whether you're saints, you must go. Aaron didn't murmur, didn't complain, didn't growl, didn't grumble, and he went on and died there on Mount Horeb. Now, same thing applied to our Lord. In Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 7, the Bible said he was oppressed and was afflicted, and he opened not his mouth. Jesus didn't complain about the death he was facing at Calvary to any human being. He talked to his Father about it in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, "Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me." That is, if it be your will, me to escape being made sin, well and good. But if not, Father, I came to do your will. He didn't complain about it. He said, "I'm willing to do your will." In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Jesus saw something ahead that caused him to move on toward Calvary, move on toward Calvary. He saw what's going to be accomplished. He saw you. He saw me. He saw there'd be a time when you would sit down with him in heaven. I would sit down with him in heaven. He saw where all saints of God would do likewise, and he moved on. He said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." And he moved on toward Calvary. Number five, we find that Aaron died on a mount. He died upon a little mountain, on a mount. Verse 25, "Take Aaron and Eleazar his son, bring them up unto Mount Hor." There we find Aaron died on Mount Hor. Jesus Christ also died on a mount, Mount Moriah. To him, no doubt, it was a solemn climb, leaving all behind him, never to see their faces again on the earth. When Aaron left that crowd, that gang of church members that followed them out of Egypt, he realized when he turned his back and said goodbye, he'd never see them again up on the face of the earth. He didn't complain. He set his face like a flint and went to Mount Horeb. So did Jesus. Jesus set his face like a flint to go up to Jerusalem to die, and died there on Mount Moriah, there where the Mosque of Omar is resting today. And like Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, the Son of God was lifted up on Calvary, and there died hanging on that middle cross. Beloved, our Savior set his face like a flint and died on a mount. A handful of corn on Mount Calvary destined to fill the whole earth. The Bible says in Psalms chapter 72 and verse 16, "There shall be a handful of corn in the earth upon the top of a mountain. The fruit thereof shall shake like Lebanon, and there the city shall flourish like grass of the earth." Jesus said, "Unless a grain of corn fall in the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it dies, much fruit will come from it." Jesus Christ was that grain of corn as it were on Calvary. And because of his death, many of us today know God. Then we come to thought number six, and that is he was stripped. The Bible tells us in verse 28, and Moses stripped Aaron of his garment. He was stripped. There on Mount Hor, he took his garment off of him. He had on that priestly garment, very beautiful, that had been designed from heaven, that he wore for many years. Very beautiful indeed. Read the Bible and see what it looked like. Beautiful robe indeed. And Moses just reached and took it off of him. He was stripped. Beloved, we brought nothing in this world, and we can carry nothing out. People today make a god out of this world. They make a god out of their wealth. They make a god out of pleasure. They make a god out of the mountains, out of the riversides and valleys. They make a god out of what they own. And there's not one thing you can carry with you when you leave here. You're going to leave everything you have behind. I don't care what you got. How many stocks and bonds, how much money in the bank, how much land you own, your property or whatnot. You're going to leave every bit of it here. The Bible said you brought nothing into this world and you're going to carry nothing out of this world. Now you need to remember that. Now Aaron was stripped. There they took the beautiful robe from his body. Moses did that and left him stripped. So was the Son of God. Christ was stripped even unto shame. It was a shame and disgraceful the way they took Jesus' clothes off and exposed his body before that mob of people. In Psalms chapter 22 and verse 18, he said, they parted my garments among them and cast lot upon my vesture. That's prophecy the psalmist gave many years before Jesus fulfilled that prophecy. In Matthew chapter 27 and verse 35, they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots. And so they took the purple robe off of Jesus. He had a seamless robe that he wore. And they took it off of him and left his body bare. They had to face mankind as he died on the cross. What shame and humiliation. That's the way they treated Jesus. Moses took Aaron's robe off, stripped him of his robe there on Mount Hor. The Son of God was stripped there on Mount Moriah. Then number seven, we see two were with him in his death. One was exalted in that death and one not. In verse 26, and he stripped Aaron of his garment and put it up on Eleazar. Now that was his son, one of his sons, Eleazar. And there Moses took that beautiful robe that had been designed from heaven for Aaron to wear, that he'd worn for many years as he went into the beautiful tabernacle there to worship God. And he took that robe and he placed it on Eleazar. There were two there. One was honored and one not honored. Eleazar was honored and then Moses was not honored. Eleazar had a chance to go in with God's people in the promised land. Moses did not. Two thieves died with Jesus on Mount Moriah. One went to paradise, the other went to hell. One went with Jesus, the other fell into the pit. Beloved, listen, two hang there on that cross beside Jesus. One so very near, so very close, and yet died and went to hell. One so far away, and yet died and went to paradise. And Jesus said, today shall thou be with me in paradise. Moses shut out of the promised land because of not believing God. Numbers chapter 20 and verse 12 tells you because of his unbelief, he couldn't go into that promised land. One thief went to paradise because he believed God. One thief went to hell because he refused to believe God. Now people go to hell because of their unbelief. They refuse to take Christ as their Savior and they die in their sins. One on the cross said, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. The other said, if you be the Son of God, come on down from there and save yourself. Said, if you be the Son of God. And he died and went to hell. You can't go to heaven on a big if. You got to believe, trust Jesus Christ without a doubt if you go to heaven. And so that's what happened. We move to thought number eight. Finally, his work was continued after he was gone. In verse 28, Aaron's mantle fell upon Eleazar, his son. Moses took that mantle, placed on Eleazar, and the work of Aaron continued on after he died through his son as he ministered there in the tabernacle. We find Elijah's mantle fell on Elisha, and Elisha continued on doing the great work of Elijah. He said, let a double portion of spirit be upon me, And he performed exactly twice as many miracles as Elijah did. And then we found the Holy Ghost fell upon the people on the day of Pentecost to continue the work of Christ. Jesus said, I'm going back to heaven. And if I go back to heaven, he said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. And he will come and you continue the work I'm doing. So the Holy Ghost came on the day of Pentecost to abide in the believers and with the believers right on to the rapture. And today we're doing the work of Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit. His work continues on. He said, greater things ye shall do than these, because I go to my Father. And the greatest things we're doing today is the outreach of the gospel, getting out to multitudes that Jesus did not reach personally in his day. Here's something here I want to pass on to you and show you what value is in serving God and how terrible it is not to serve God in respect to your descendants. In the early part of the 18th century, there lived Jonathan Edwards and Mac Jukes. Now remember those names. Jonathan Edwards was a great and mighty preacher. Mac Jukes was a wicked man. Mac Jukes, the atheist, lived a godless life. He married an ungodly girl, and from the union there were 310 who died as paupers, 150 were criminals, 7 were murderers, 100 were drunkards, more than half of the women were prostitutes. His 540 descendants cost the state $1.25 million. That was descendants of Max Jukes because he was an atheist and didn't believe in God. Now, Jonathan Edwards, a man of God, a great American, lived at the same time of Max Jukes. He married a godly girl. An investigation was made of 1,394 known descendants of Jonathan Edwards, of which 13 became college presidents, 65 college professors, 3 United States senators, 30 became judges, 100 became lawyers, 60 became physicians, 75 Army, Navy officers, and so forth. 100 became preachers and missionaries, 60 authors of prominence, 1 a vice president of the United States, 80 became public officials in other capacities, 295 college graduates, among whom were governors of states and ministers to foreign countries. His descendants did not cost the state a single penny. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 7, the memory of the just is blessed. Now you can leave your family and make a count on down the line. Or you can live like the devil and that'll follow you as you sojourn. Wouldn't you rather live like Jonathan Edwards and Mac Jukes? I know you would. And you can. God help you to do so. Let's stand our feet. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll take the message and use it. Reach out in the radio listening audience and speak to hearts. Bless thy people here in this auditorium. Get glory to thyself. God, for some here rebellious, I pray that you speak to their hearts. May Jesus be glorified. I pray in his name and for his sake. Amen. Now while the organist plays, and pray too, I hope, then Brother Tony will be down front here to meet you. If you'll come down, I'll help you. If you feel like you need to come forward, you come on today. If you need to join the church or come back to God or get right with the Lord, whatever. If God is speaking, just come on down. We want to help you. I brought you the message God laid on my heart. It's up to you now to respond to the invitation. How about it? Would you come? Come on now, if God is speaking.